First of all, I believe from whatever the judgments have come and so on, the role of AICT is still a regulator, is that of a regulator. So there's nothing like there are in an operative part of a judgment, there are something to be done and some observations come. So I don't think the role of AICT has been that of a advisor. It's still a regulator. And as far as the points that have been made in the within the court, we have moved the court. So there are technically the issue is sub judice, and we would like to see that the role of AICT as envisaged within its act, that of providing a coordinated development, setting standards, maintaining standards for technical education in the country, will be preserved. I mean, that's in the larger interest of the nation. The role of AICT has been the same before, is the same now. We are still a regulator. A part of affiliated colleges probably is the gray area, which we are looking at by filing appropriate replies in the court, and we hope that the larger values of the act under which AICT was formed is preserved. The polytechnics approach now, the PGDM institutions in fact approach, which are basically management institutions, they approach AICT. In one of the cases earlier, the Honorable Supreme Court has said that PGDM institutions will still approach AICT. So a lot of things are still being heard, they are being interpreted, they are being defined. So I believe we'll have to wait for some time. As far as we are concerned, the AICT in the last 5 years has executed a very authentic role, I believe. The entire approval process is online today. An applicant sits at home and he makes an application, sits at home, looks at his deficiencies through a report that is generated online. He gets to print the approval letter also sitting at home. So I don't know which other regulators would be doing this. And all our visits that we send, be it on the basis of complaints or be it while an institution is set up new, they are all eminent people. The random selection happens on the portal of the experts, and they are also, all our committees have retired High Court judges. So what more transparent? I mean, the whole data of the institutions is available in the public domain. So the whole portal is RTI compliant. Now, I believe all this has led to a lot of transparency, accountability. The entire payment for the different services that are rendered goes through an online payment gateway. So therefore, whoever it is, I mean, we should move out from armchair wrestle in print, in media, as to see whose role is what will the regulator do, what will the courts do, what will the society do, what will the institutions do. I think we should move out from that kind of debate and concentrate on what the Act specifies as the role of AICT, that of a regulator, which it has been doing for 30 years now. Yes, every organization has a semblance of difficulty. I believe AICT also had in the past. But the organizations have to move forward. I'll give you 2-3 small examples. When we started 5 years back, we had 3.8 lakh teachers in the system. Today, I have 6 lakh teachers in the system. We had just about 5.5 lakh enrollment at that time. Today, this year, I have an enrollment of 1.26 million students in 13-14. So the access has increased. The quality metrics is improving. 5 years back, we had two-third BTECs as faculty with BTEC qualifications and one-third of MTEC qualifications and with 35,000 PhDs. Now I have reversed that ratio. So today we have two-thirds of MTech faculty, one-third of BTech faculty, and I have 52,000 PhD faculty. Has the system not improved? Has the system not delivered? Now, we really need to see what are the technicalities within the Act. Some portion of it is up to the government to make a rectification through an ordinance, through an amendment, and so on. And certain parties, I believe the society has to look at. See, we don't close down organizations. We change the structure of the organization. We change people in the within the organizations if systems go wrong. Systems don't fail. People who run the systems fail. So therefore, our courts, which are also part of society, keeps the conscience of the society. We believe they will do adequately what is required in restoring the powers of AICT. We have 700 universities, out of which about 280 are in the state sector, state-owned universities. About 40-odd central universities are there. About 400-odd deemed and private universities are there. Many of the regulatory provisions are not really applicable, be it from the UGC or be it from the AICT, to private and deemed universities. So there is a lot of expansion and the associated problem areas with that are associated with expansion happen in that sector. But I do believe that transparency and accountability is a must in any organization. Because we are all ultimately the protectors for the interests of the society. So having multiple standards, if it goes into the university systems, how best entry 66, provisions of that, schedule 7, list 1 can be implemented, where the center has a role in prescribing the standards, policy making and so on. These are all very difficult questions in future. Yes, I appreciate that, but I mean, like I said, for so many universities to come out with systems which are absolutely transparent, and there are a lot of issues that are desirable in many of those places that you have cited. But I believe in a larger context, the national interest will be preserved. I mean, I won't want to go into details of what the universities can do or will do or will not do, how the system. Of course, two, three things will be very, very real in time to come. If we leave it to the universities, a lot of commercialization can set in. People, parents, students, a lot of exploitation can happen because the systems are not very robust in those places. And now if you say that 280 universities will come into play, the job which was being done by one, and many of the universities have been set up very recently. So there could be some problem areas there. But like I said, in the first place, why was AICT created? There is an act of parliament. In fact, it came about as an advisory body in 1945. Even before UGC existed. So therefore, somebody in 1987, from 1945 to 1987, in 1987 when the Act was formulated, the entire technical education, that of engineering, architecture, pharmacy, management, applied arts, all hotel management, catering technology, all these have been put together as technical education, and an Act has been formulated for that purpose. Whereas we had 52 colleges in 1947 when we got independence, today you have 12,000 colleges. And yes, I mean, every large system has its share of incongruencies and so on. But that should not become a rallying point to close down an organization. We need to improve systems, we need to improve organizations. And I believe in the last 5 years we've done that. So therefore, my request to all concerned is to see that in the national interest this organization is strengthened, is revived, and make it accountable. Make it as accountable as possible. We have had several meetings on this side. Fundamentally, if you look at the PPP as a model, it has largely succeeded in infrastructural projects. When it is applied to other areas, there has been a lot to be desired. Now, obviously, what happens is in a public-private partnership kind of working, you need to define the objectives, the roles of each of them, and fix very definitive deliverables to each of them and see what is the revenue sharing model. Now, education is not a profit-making profession in this country. So it's a non-profit making entity. So therefore, if you create a PPP and if you start saying that there is a revenue sharing in this and you recover the costs and so on, so somebody will have to work out what is that incremental rate that happens, growth in rate that happens in terms of recovery of amount, and when does it stop, and when does one own the institution, or who owns the institution after such a period. Now, all these are extremely important points before a PPP in education pitch is made. But the idea is not so much as PPP, as much as getting the industry into this activity. I believe several industries, I come from Mumbai, so there are several, I know the situation there. Several industries, big industries, for example, Godrej, for example, Siemens, L&T, they all have a lot of land with them, and they can, with all the best practices that they have, with all the expertise that they have, they can certainly use a part of that surplus land to set up some quality institutions with collaborations from some of the best of the institutions across the world. Now, that can be certainly a part of PPP model. So it's not necessary that you always have a financial input to create a PPP model. So I believe new models will have to emerge. We are working on them. We had a committee which has actually submitted a report, and taking off from that report, earlier we used to allow only government lease for setting up institutions, but now we will be allowing private lease as well, for essentially to help out the industries to, because what happens is industry has a land, it has to create a society, a trust or whatever, and the land that it has to turn it in the name of that trust or society. Now, while doing this, it becomes a private lease. So earlier rules prevented us from doing that. Now we have opened that sector, and we are also talking to several industries. So this PPP model, as it has evolved in the beginning, will need to undergo some changes, and we are working on that. And probably in the next 6 months' time, we'll come out with a good model where the industry would feel very encouraged to participate in promoting higher education. After all, the product that comes from these institutions are going to enrich their organizations. Under this scheme, we have got about 20 odd institutions. We have a target of about 300, but like I said, there are obvious difficulties. We recently had a meeting with all the industry representatives. We have also written to them to suggest from their point of view what kind of model can succeed. And therefore, we are on that, and we hope something tangible will come. See, the educational organizations are there anyway in this business. Our value addition can happen through value-added propositions from the student's perspective, from the faculty's perspective. It doesn't happen by bringing another educational organization into space, because they have their own limitations, their own projected objectives and so on. So therefore, in order to build quality into a system, an industry owning up the institution is extremely important. In what way it will do is matter of detailing, which we'll have to work out so that it becomes win-win for both sides. So my personal belief is that we need to get on to some models where the industry participates, not the bigger educational institutions supporting smaller educational institutions through PPP and so on. I don't think PPP is for that. For example, a student value addition happens, a faculty value addition happens, if every one of them goes through a 3-month, 6-month internship in their time period of 4 years or whatever. A teacher, a faculty should do a 6-month internship every 3 years, 4 years, so on. So that their own understanding of the outside world improves. Therefore, their teaching learning process improves. If they are doing an MTech project, if they're doing a PhD project, let them go to the industry. The industry should support not through namesake projects, but through actual intervention, through hands-on intervention. And all this can happen only if the industry has a stake in that institution. Today, you can only appeal to them, which we are doing anyway. So they will probably go to the best of the institutions to do that. They will approach the IITs, they will approach the NITs and some of the best institutions in the government sector. Beyond that, there is neither the capacity built, nor the interest, nor there is any need from the industry's perspective. As long as their needs are taken care of, they will not venture beyond that. Therefore, we need to create an alternative mechanism whereby we need to bring in the MSMEs, at least the larger of them, into this education space. Today, somehow we have kept the MSMEs out for various reasons. They themselves have kept themselves out, or we have not approached them. So therefore, we need to identify the bigger ones there, bring them into the education sector. Probably some PPP can happen there, they owning up and showing a value proposition for the expansion of their organizations, for the research input that they require, and so on. All in all, my belief is that unless you come out with new models which will interest people to invest money, nothing will happen. There are always those people who will look at this as a value proposition from their personal growth perspective. That has been happening over a period of time. We have businessmen, who have nothing to do with education setting up institutions. So their primary interest will be in something else. They are running this because it adds value to their professional profile. So at least now we should create a policy where the genuine people come into the education space. We need a lot of expansion. 500, half of our population will be below age of 30 in the next probably 10 years time. And that's a huge problem area for any country to handle. And if I say that 50 million students today go to colleges, give exams between 10th, 11th and 12th, and half of that population, 25 million, go to colleges. And that 25 million contributes to your 18 GER. You know, 18 GER is very, very low compared to the global standards. Now, suppose I say that you improve the supply chain, the school systems you improve, teaching methodologies you improve, you give better inputs to students. Instead of 25 million, suppose you get 40 million tomorrow who are seeking college admissions. Simple fact is that we don't even have colleges or universities to accommodate them. Are we going to create this additional capacity in the next 5-6 years? I think we must be fooling ourselves in trying to understand that this will happen, that will happen, and more colleges will come. So therefore, on one side, you need to expand. You need to create enabling mechanisms to expand the formal system. On the other side, you need to create alternative education systems, skill building, associated with partly with education, provide multiple pathways, let them get into the systems, improve your economy side from the demand side, and you create more job opportunities, improve the economy, GDP, and that's how the whole system will grow. You can't possibly say that I don't have sufficient jobs to provide, and therefore I'll restrict the supply side and not let everybody who is interested in education go through education. That will be disastrous for any country. So if you have numbers, you have to provide for education. Everybody who wants education should go through that every child should go through school, go through colleges. You should create financial models for them to sustain themselves. And you also need to create the ability for them to provide, get into meaningful jobs. That is how the system should grow. Not restrict the supply side or the demand side to suit each other. I can't have an examination system in place, put in place, which says, which essentially caters to my availability of seats in colleges and says that I'll restrict my passing percentages to 50% or 40% or 60%, because if I make it 65% by improving the systems, I won't be able to get them seat in a college, and it becomes a political challenge for me, or it becomes a social challenge for me. Therefore, we as a society should evolve. The entire approach to education must be progressive, create enabling mechanisms, create financial models. I would like the state governments, the center, to pitch in with some corpus funding, and also the private sector. Even if they give a small amount of their CSR into this corpus, you create a value from the interest of which can fund at least a part of the population to move through that value chain. That is what is required.